Dear friends, a warm and a hearty welcome to the Redemptorist Media Center. Thank you for joining us on this spiritual pilgrimage as we prepare for the great solemnity of Christmas along with St. Alphonsus Liguori, the founder of the Redemptorists. During the novena, we request you to kindly keep its success as one of your prayer intentions. Today is day one of the novena, and the theme for our meditation is, Though He is God, Jesus became human. We will be led in our reflections by Father Juventius Andrade from Bangalore, India. Father Juvy, as he is affectionately called, has a licentiate in Scripture from the Biblicum in Rome and in Jerusalem. He has taught Scripture and Homiletics to many Redemptorists and others, both in India and abroad. Having served for 2 terms as a General Consultor, he currently serves in the Provincial Council of the Province of Bangalore. Let us now begin this novena with the opening hymn.
Day 1, 16th December. Think about the great love God has shown us by becoming human in order to obtain eternal life for us. Our first parents, Adam and Eve, rebelled against God and were driven out of paradise. As a result, they and all of us, their descendants, were condemned to everlasting death. But the Son of God, grieving because humanity was lost, took upon Himself our human flesh. Then, in order to save us from death, He died on a cross, condemned as a criminal. We might imagine God the Father saying to His Son, "My child, consider the hardships you will have to undergo while on earth. You will be born in a cold cave, with no place to be laid except in the trough where animals come to feed. As an infant, you will have to flee to Egypt to escape the hands of Herod. After returning, you will have to live in a workshop as a poor, humble servant. And finally, worn out by sufferings, you will have to give up your life, dying on a cross, insulted and forsaken by all. And Jesus would respond, "Father, it does not matter. I am happy to endure whatever comes, provided that humanity is saved." How would we react if a millionaire took compassion on a dead worm and chose to become a worm himself, offering his own blood as a transfusion, and died in order to restore life to the other worm? Yet, the eternal Word has done even more than that for us. God, the Creator, has become like us, one of His own creatures, to share in our human life so that we can share once again in His divine life. When God realized that all the natural gifts He had bestowed on us could not win our love for Him, He became one of us and gave Himself entirely to us. The Word became flesh and lived amongst us. John chapter 1, verse 14a. Through sin, humanity separated itself from God. But God, because of His great love for us, came from heaven to seek us. Why? In order that we might realize how much God loves us, and in gratitude, love God in return. Anytime a cat or a dog comes to us from across the room, we can't help but respond by petting it and speaking to it. So why do we ignore God who comes to us all the way from heaven? Once, when a priest proclaimed the words, "And the Word became flesh," someone in the church neglected to make a proper reverence. This prompted the devil to give that person a blow, saying, "O ungrateful one, if only God had done for me what He has done for you, I would remain with my head always bowed down in thanksgiving."
Today we begin a 9-day novena in preparation for Christmas, or more accurately, 9 meditations. Now when we hear the word novena, we tend to think of the novena to our Mother of Perpetual Help. But actually, novena comes from the Latin word nove, which means 9. And in fact, it is a traditional form of prayer prayed over 9 days. It's soundly based in Scripture because the first novena can be found in the Acts of the Apostles, actually chapter 1 verse 14, when Mary, the Mother of God, accompanied the disciples as they waited for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at the first feast of Pentecost. Before we begin a reflection on the day's theme, I like to place the 9-day meditation, this novena, in context. Now, St. Alphonsus wrote a series of novenas and meditations arising out of his own prayer and out of his own experience, and therefore he wrote a novena for Pentecost, a novena for Christmas. But what specifically does a novena or the meditations consist of? You could say they were a series of meditations to give us a deeper understanding of God, a God event. That's what we call a faith or a theological mystery. Now, a mystery is not a riddle to be solved, but rather it is an invitation to enter into the very heart of God, which is so vast that we cannot fully grasp it in just a few settings. We get merely a glimpse of it. And it's so deep that we need to expand on this further. Now, the novena, the 9-day meditation, was a way of unfolding the mystery, the different dimensions of the God event. And so these 9 days lead themselves to 9 meditations. They would basically consist of a scripture passage, a reflection based on the theme to help us understand this mystery, this God event, even better. From this arose prayers that sprung from the heart. And then the meditation concludes with some kind of a faith conviction or a decision to act, what we sometimes call a resolution. Now, the meditation is not just mere thoughts. By meditating on the mystery or even participating in it, you were drawn into a deeper intimacy with God, a greater growth in discipleship, and a firmer commitment to action. So you could say that it calls for a wonderful continuity with what you ponder in your mind, what you nourish in your hearts, and what you want to live in your lives. Now, for St. Alphonsus, there were four mainstays of his spirituality. Simply put, the crib, the incarnation, the cross, the passion, death, and redemption, the Eucharist, and of course, Mary. And each of these four mainstays were rooted in love. Now, during these 9 days of meditation of this novena, focusing on the crib, which is really the mystery of the incarnation, God becoming human, we will be looking at different aspects of it. Though he was God, Jesus became human. Though he was great, he became little. Though he was rich, he became poor. And so we will be unfolding these different themes during these days. Having spelt out this background, this setting, let us begin, therefore, with this first meditation. Though he was God, Jesus became human. Several years ago, my scripture professor in the seminary, Father Sean Kelleher, enumerated different political and ideological systems which were seen as repressive and oppressive, and then he spoke of leaders who tried to put, as it were, a human face on these systems. I did a little research on that, and I'd like to present it today. In April 1968, in what was then the one country of Czechoslovakia, under the Soviet system, there was a great disillusionment with the people with how that system was functioning. And so the then leader, Alexander Dubček, together with his colleagues, got together at trying to work out ways to address what he found was the cause of disillusion. It was referred to then as the Prague Spring. It didn't last long because the Soviet armies made sure that was ended. But I want to draw attention to Alexander Dubček, the leader who said he wanted to put a human face on capitalism. Move forward to 15th May 1973 to the United Kingdom. The then Prime Minister Edward Heath, while addressing a debate in the House of Commons in their parliament, he was trying to address some of the flaws in capitalism that were only too manifest. Some of because of the scandals of big business, exploiting tax loopholes, taking of bribes, disregarding workers' conditions. And he said, this is an unacceptable face of capitalism. What he was trying to say is, let's put a human face on capitalism. Move to the decade later, because in 1985, when Mikhail Gorbachev of the Soviet Union became the head of the Communist Party and the leader of the nation, he saw that people were greatly being disillusioned with communism. And so therefore, he introduces true words, perestroika, meaning restructuring, and glasnost, which means openness. And he tried to bring about some changes in the system. Greater civil rights, lifting up of some of the censorship. You could say that it was his attempt to put a human face on communism. Now, you might wonder, where am I going with all these comparisons? In the Old Testament, God was known with different titles and with known through his many deeds. In fact, the people yearned, however, to see the face of God. But however, we find in Exodus chapter 33, verse 20, you cannot see the face of God and live. Despite that, people were yearning, and therefore in Isaiah 64 verse 1, the people cried, "Oh, that you would tear the heavens and come down." You could say that a little more than 2,000 years ago, the Father, seeing the yearning of the people, the Father fulfilling the prophecies that were made, sent His Son Jesus, God Himself, who would become human and live among us, like us in all ways but sin. In the letter to the Colossians chapter 3 verse 15, we are told that He is the visible image of the invisible God. You could say that God, the Father, put a human face on God. So God is no longer just a power, a principle, a force, or energy, but a person with a face, with a heart, with a name. And His name is Jesus. So you could see that Jesus, fully God, chooses to become fully human as well. Jesus, although God, became human. Now, it's quite a challenge to grasp all of this, because when God chooses to become human, how are we to ever understand something like this? But the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians puts it rather well. And I'd like to read for you from chapter 2, verse 6 onwards. Christ Jesus, who, though He was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied Himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Although He was in the form of God, Jesus did not cling to His power. He did not exploit this power. He emptied Himself. Now, why would Jesus even think of doing what in human terms seems so unimaginable? To willingly give up position, power, and take your lot among weak and vulnerable humanity. Why would Jesus, Almighty God, choose to become the all-vulnerable God? Why would Jesus, the all-powerful God, endure the experience of powerlessness and even death at the hands of mere mortals? Why in heaven's name would God want to give up all these privileges? Saint Alphonsus reminds us, it's simply because of love. In his bestseller, The Practice of the Love of Jesus Christ, St. Alphonsus wrote, and I'd like to quote, "Without the assurance of faith, could anyone ever have believed that an omnipotent, that all-powerful God, Lord of all and supremely happy in Himself, was capable of loving human beings to the extent of appearing to be out of His mind, crazy, with love for them?" From The Practice of Love of Jesus Christ. God became human out of love. A crazy, overwhelming, almost unthinkable love. And that love drove God to dwell among us, to take human flesh and to dwell in our hearts. Only a crazy love can do crazy things. St. Alphonsus notes that people are drawn to love a baby. So God became a helpless, vulnerable infant to win our love, says St. Alphonsus. He wrote that God could have appeared as a fully grown person, a mighty ruler, a person of great influence, but He came as an infant, that He might show how great His love is for us. St. Alphonsus notes that we as humans are made in the image of God, but now, with this incarnation, God is made in our image. God became human. Now, my dear sisters and brothers, in becoming human, Jesus chose to come into our world, to get inside our skin, to feel within our hearts, to become like one of us. In becoming human, Jesus laughed as we did. And he also experienced pain, hurt, just as we do. In becoming human, Jesus went through every human experience, joyful and happy, painful and sorrowful. God in Christ Jesus experienced the very worst, you would say. In the eyes of people, he was seen as the son of an unwed mother. He was homeless at birth, a refugee in Egypt. He was called all sorts of names, a glutton and a drunkard. He experienced suffering at the hands of many, including his inner circle of 12. One denied him, another betrayed him, the others, most of them, abandoned him. He was judged unjustly, stripped, scourged, nailed to the cross, and then assassinated and murdered like a common criminal. No longer can we say, does God know what it means to suffer all this, even to the point of death? God knows. God knows it in Christ Jesus, who, although God, became human. So God is no longer just a principle, a power, a force, or energy, but a person with a face, a name, a heart, and his name is Jesus. Our God is Emmanuel, God with us, not far away, not against, not remote, but God with us. And so let us meditate on this deep enough and long enough to know that we are so loved by a God who loves us so crazily. And let this sink in deep and hard, because this is what Alphonsus wants us to do in the first of the 9 meditations. Having reflected on this theme, what then must we do? The first, as we have just seen, is to realize how much we are loved by God. God loves us so much that God, as he is, he emptied himself to become human in order to take his place among us and with us. Now, knowing and believing and experiencing this in our hearts also has consequences. If God has now become human, we must now seek his face, not only in the grandeur of nature, but also in the vulnerability of human existence. Jesus chooses even now, even today, to reveal himself in his humanness. Just think, when the Christians were being persecuted by Saul, later to become Paul, in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, verse 4, Jesus challenges him, "Why are you persecuting me?" He identifies himself with his human followers. But this was not limited to Christians alone, because at the last judgment in Matthew 25, we will be judged precisely on this. When I was hungry or thirsty or naked or homeless in prison, insofar as you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. God becoming human was not just a Christmas event. It was a lifelong and a universe extensive event. That's the first point I would like to make. The second element is this. In becoming human, God in Christ Jesus made a clear choice of self-emptying, or as the Greek word says, kenosis. It means emptying ourselves of all that makes us less human or even inhuman. It means emptying ourselves of the revenge, the bitterness, the jealousy, the gossip, the putting down, all that is venom and poison. It means avoiding any use and abuse of power that breaks rather than builds up the kingdom of God. And Jesus shows us how. Jesus shows us what self-emptying, the kenosis, is all about. Although he was God, Jesus did not count equality with God as something to be exploited, something to cling to, something to hold on to. This all-powerful God becomes the all-vulnerable God. And Jesus shows precisely how power is to be exercised. His power is manifest not in clinging to position, power, and authority for self-gain and for self-promotion. That is the way of the world. Political leaders will do all that in order to cling to power and authority for themselves. They will change the constitutions in some countries. They will use brute force. They will manipulate the elections and the voting. They believe they have the right to cling on to the seat of the power and to hang on to authority for life. Sadly, this is not restricted only to the political world. The same temptation lies even in the church and among church groups. Jesus did not count equality with God as something to be grasped and clung to. Not all who claim to his disciples live by that. So much of self-emptying is needed by disciples, the laity and church leaders particularly. This self-emptying embraces concerns like jealousy and revenge, domination and discrimination. Within the church sometimes also, there is the naked desire and the yearning for position and power, political ambition, ecclesial careerism, a struggle for power, financial gain, holding on to office, not letting go of it. This remains a curse that goes against the spirit of Jesus, our God, who gave it all up. You know, we end up not in a love-crazy world, as Alphonsus describes it, but in a power-crazy mode, as the corrupt world defines it. You know, when we read the hymn, the text that I read for you, I read from verse 6, but when you turn to verse 5, that's important because it sets the orientation to the text that follows. And what does it say in verse 5? Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. Have that same mind and heart of Jesus. The person of Jesus is not for mere admiration. It's for imitation and for following. There is so much more. We can reflect on this wonderful God event, the mystery of the incarnation, God becoming flesh. And that is why we have 8 days more of reflections and meditations to come. May these meditations help us to enter into the wonder of celebrating the mystery of God becoming human. I'd like to conclude with a prayer of Saint Alphonsus. My beloved Jesus, you have imprisoned yourself in swaddling clothes because of your love for me. I will become a prisoner of your infinite love. Bind me tight so that I may never be able to disengage myself from your love. Amen.
Let us pray. Son of God, you became human in order to make yourself lovable to us. But where is the love that we should have for you in return? After all, you have given your life to save us. Yet why are we so indifferent to your presence? I admit that I myself have not always paid attention to you, your love, or your gifts. But your birth, your death, and resurrection, the gift of Eucharist, provide me with hope. Forgive the times that I have failed to acknowledge your influence in my life. I love you, O incarnate Word. I love you, O my God. I love you, O infinite goodness. And I ask forgiveness for all the sins that I have committed, large and small, public or private. I wish that I could die for you. Dear Jesus, give me the gift of love for you. Let me never again feel complacent over the trials you have endured for me. I want to love you always. Give me perseverance in loving you. O Mary, Mother of God, and my Mother too, obtain for me from your Son the grace to love him always, even unto death. Amen.
Well begun is half done. So we are well on our way to a fruitful preparation for Christmas. Tomorrow, on day 2, we shall reflect on the theme, Though he is great, Jesus made himself little. the homily will be delivered by Father Michael Kelleher, C.Ss.R. See you again tomorrow at the same time, 6 a.m. IST, or any time of your convenience. And remember to share this link with all your near and dear ones. As they say in Konkani, Deo Barenkorum. May God bless you all mightily. God, so much.